guys, welcome back. This is Matt Chat episode 194, featuring the fourth and final installment of my interview with Mr. Neal Hallford, the designer of Betrayal at Krondor. This part of the interview, we talk about Dungeon Siege, Champions of Norrath, the state of the video games industry, and what Neal thinks of Mr. Chris Taylor of Gas Powered Games. A lot of great stuff here, so without further ado, here is Mr. Neal Hallford.
Well, you know, you've mentioned Dungeon Siege a few times, and that's another game I like. And, you know, I had Chris on, I guess that was about a couple years ago now, and I remember one of the things when we started talking about Dungeon Siege, he said the game would have been a lot better if it had been a lot shorter. He thought there was just too much content for one game and for the resources they had available. So I just wonder, what's your take on Dungeon Siege?
That's possibly true. I think that there were a lot of things I learned about Dungeon Siege, because number one, you see that it's in that same ballpark of talking about letting you start and you figure out where you're going to go. So there was definitely that in its favor. In terms of whether it was like had too much content and it was too big and all this other stuff, I don't know. It's so weird for me because I think back to whenever I was playing games as a kid and it wasn't unusual for me to spend a month playing a game. You know, I put in 300 hours or something into getting XY game done. And it's so funny now. It's like, how many hours of gameplay do you get out? Oh, I got 10 hours, 15 hours out of it. And they're just like, this is incredible. And it's did you not get out of the first level? You know, what the deal is. And so I have kind of a different perspective on that sort of thing. I thought it was a really great title. I mean, I think that the only regret I have is, of course, is about my own kind of connection with it, because Gaspar Games has a slightly different way of kind of dealing with content than other companies do. Is they build the tech and it gets fairly far along. They even start building some levels that they're really cool, awesome kind of levels. And then a lot of times it's a point where they will bring in, you know, me and say, hey, Neal, okay, we have this stuff that's going on. We need you to explain what the world is and kind of create a story that hooks all the stuff together, which, of course, coming from my background of spending a lot of time world building and everything else, at first blush, the first time that ever happened, like, can't do that. That's the wrong way to do it. You write a story and then you come up with an engine that tells that story. But the one thing I actually kind of really realized that I liked about the whole thing is that, number one, it was gameplay rooted in gameplay. So it wasn't a game that was designed to tell a story. You know, it's a story that kind of helps kind of enrich the gameplay. I kind of call it my box of rocks concept, is the fact that you open up that you say, okay, here's a bunch of cool stuff in here, open it up and tell a story about what's in here. And it sounds bizarre and kind of random, but it worked. The only regret that I have is that there's actually so much story that I created for that game that never made it in. Because there was the kind of story that goes on and stuff that happens inside of Dungeon Siege, but I went back and wrote about 100 pages of back history to the world. There's 10,000 years of history that takes place before you get to Dungeon Siege. So all this other stuff is sitting in a Bible. Most people never even get to see that stuff, but I have to write it so I understand the way. And so it's kind of funny because I would retro-engineer stuff. Then I would take this Bible and I would send it back north to them, and then I get these notes back from the artists or from the, oh my god, I never understood that before, and they'd start messing with stuff and they get really excited and they start redoing the levels or adding stuff to the levels based on the stuff I'd written for the universe, because again, it's that emotional connection to understanding this has a history and this has a real, and there's a reason that it's there. I actually got into a really big tiff one time with on Dungeon Siege, where there was a graveyard and they had crosses on the graves. And I said, okay, I have a small problem with this because it's a very specific symbol. You know, and granted, you can come up with the whole mythology for what the cross means in this universe and everything else. I said, but it kind of feels like I'm yanked out of the universe because that's a cross that's on this universe. Can we come up with some other symbol, you know, just, or even if we just, you know, bend the arms on the crosses down or some other stuff. And so, because I said that every time you just randomly grab some existing symbol out of our universe, it starts to feel like, okay, well, I'm just doing this patchwork and of stuff. Give me a reason that symbol means something different here, and people need to understand that it has a different meaning here. And of course, you can make the opposite argument. Well, it's archetypal. You instantly know there's a graveyard because I see there's a cross on the graves, and there's a very valid argument for that as well. I'm a hardcore world builder. I want to know that this build, you created something brand new here, and you didn't like off the racket. You know, here's, you know, culture du jour. That's one of my biggest regrets is that I just really wish there had been a way to tell more of that backstory and get more of what's going on. I know that in Dungeon Siege 2 that I was actually unfortunately tied up at the time of Dungeon Siege 2, so I wasn't actually able to really write for it. They used some of the materials from the back story in it, but unfortunately, they kind of just grabbed a few things out of the Bible and just kind of threw the stuff in. It wasn't really my universe anymore, and that's one of the things that you just feel kind of uncomfortable with. And I knew exactly how Ray felt, you know, from the standpoint of now there's the people messing around with animals. That's not what I meant at all. Ray Fife got mad at me because I invented gunpowder in his universe, and gunpowder doesn't work in Ray's universe, as he let me know. Or didn't work in his universe at that particular period of time. There was something really weird about that. But I guess if I had anything, it was mainly about I wish that I could have had, I'd been involved a little bit earlier in the process so that we can do some stuff. And so that said, if Wildman is successful and everything else, I will be in charge of the lore for Wildman. So I will be involved from sort of the get-go on this one. So anyway, I hope that answered your question. That was kind of a long ramble.
What about Champions of Norrath? I wanted to, you know, get your take on that game.
Champions of Norrath, of course, is a title that, just understand, is that something I helped out on. That's not really my baby. I was working at Hands On Entertainment down here in San Diego. We were doing the real-time strategy game Lords of EverQuest, which was, unfortunately, everybody thought it was an expansion of EverQuest, and nobody understood it because of that, because they thought it was an expansion. They got it and they go, what the hell is this? And they didn't know what it was. While I was working on Lords of EverQuest, at the same time, I was contacted by the folks at Snowbind Studio because Rich Lawrence, who was at Sony Online, had basically said, you need to talk to Neil because he's good at telling stories and everything else. So Snowbind contacted me and said, we need some help with the story that we're developing for Champions. And they already had kind of an outline for what they wanted done, but they just needed me to come in, flesh it out, write some dialogue for them, and also build out certain, they had some areas where they didn't really necessarily have a hard story for the area yet. And so I went out and kind of fleshed it out quite a bit. But that was kind of a cool project because I, at the time, had never actually met Chris Avalon. Chris Avalon and I were both, we knew of each other. We actually didn't know each other at that point. But I was writing stuff. And at one point, I got an email from Chris Avalon. And he'd been reading over some of my material because Chris also, you know, contributed to that title. And I got an email from Chris. He says, man, I don't, you know, we never met before. And we haven't talked. I was reading some of the stuff you wrote, and I just laughed my ass off. You know, this is really incredible stuff. And so so that was my first opportunity to get to know Chris Avalon. And so that's, we've been friends ever since. But so with Champions of Norrath, it was a great fun little title. It was exciting for me because it was actually my first console title that I actually had anything in. And of course, it did very, very well. And, you know, another thing there in the Norrath EverQuest, you know, kind of universe of things.
Yeah, so as long as we're talking about consoles, I know that was an action, sort of action RPG set in EverQuest. Just wondering, why do you think it's taken so long for the MMO World of Warcraft style game to really make its way onto consoles?
I think that partially is the casualness to some degree. Is there's also the casual nature of what the consoles at least were. I mean, they've moved away from Super Mario, Legend of Zelda, you know, very kind of light, you know, kinds of stuff to, yeah, I need to get together with my guild and we're going to start to do a raid. And there's this very prolonged kind of contact that you have to have with an MMO, which with Zelda or something, you know, one of the older, you know, kind of console titles, you switch it on, you play it for 15 or 20 minutes and it stops and I can come back to it. You know, I think that was very much one-to-one with that market for such a long period of time. And I think that it really took the Xbox to really say we've gotten beyond that, because, you know, even with the PS3 and obviously with all the Nintendo stuff, the console was the kiddie, you know, console. It really took Halo, you know, for all of us to say we've got a bigger audience. We got a much more mature audience than what we had, where we used to thinking of consoles about. And so it took a while to kind of unentrench people. And then all of the land-based, you know, Call of Duty and all of these games where now I'm playing in teams, it's kind of tightly organized. Once they kind of got the concept of I'm in a team, it's basically a long-term investment. And I think it took all of that before we can kind of wrap around eyes around the fact that console could be a hardcore machine. Because it's applying to the right demographic and it's in your home, and, you know, where I'm not thinking about, oh, I just need to get to the next save point. And we needed to get away from that mentality. And so I think I'm not really sure why it took that long, other than the fact that we had to kind of get out of that mindset of this is the kid's toy. You know, this is something an adult can play with, because obviously the you know, it's really all these, you know, middle-aged housewives and other people who kind of created MMOs as we know them, is that those people that I'm going to go on and it's a way for me to socialize with my friends, and hey, it's in the front room, you know, it's right here with my TV and I can have dinner on and I can go over and mess with this for a few minutes and whatever. So I think that it, growing up, it needed a better image. And of course, the irony now is that almost no one, you know, we're having a hard time, you know, kind of convincing people the PC is a gaming machine anymore, which is just surreal to me. I much prefer having my mouse, you know, to having a gamepad in my hands.
Amen.
And so I'm an old school gamer. Make me happy. Make things hard enough that it's interesting to me. But, you know, anyway.
Well, I think that pretty much brings us up to date, right, with the your gaming.
I think so. I think so.
Gaming career. So I did want to get into, just, you know, at least mention, I guess by the time this video comes out, we'll know one way or the other what, you know, the fate of Wild Man.
Yes. I certainly hope that it does make its way. Wild Man, of course, was almost every major series that Chris has worked on, I've had my fingers in to some degree or another, if I was available. You know, there have been a few times whenever he's working on titles and unfortunately just I was working full time for somebody else, or there's just some reason that things didn't work out. But I feel very lucky because I feel like Jeremy Soule and I both are kind of on Chris's call list. And even though I don't necessarily work for Gaspar Games full time, I have been so involved in almost every project they've worked on that I might as well be a an employee of Gas Power. But Chris and I had contacted me a couple of months back, and he said, I've got kind of an interesting gig. It's this new kind of game. It's an RPG, but it's has RTS elements and has some other stuff kind of blended in. And he said, I need a good story told with it. But one thing that I'm really interested in doing with it, that he and I discussed doing a Dungeon Siege novel, you know, many moons ago, whenever Dungeon Siege came out, he was interested in doing a Dungeon Siege novel. And I was interested in doing it as well. Again, I was also writing Swords and Circuitry at the time. And I was just so insanely busy. I was just going, first time I've ever written a book. And now I'm also going to add a first time novel on top of this, as well as all the text for the inside of Dungeon Siege. And again, if Jaina had not come along and helped me do some of the writing for Swords and Circuitry, I don't know if I would just have leapt off of something really tall. So anyway, we talked about it with Dungeon Siege. I actually even wrote a series of kind of short story vignette-y kind of things for Dungeon Siege, but it never really kind of proceeded past that. Anyway, so he said, I'm really interested in the idea of having a Wild Man novel, and we want to offer that as a pledge tier kind of incentive. Would you be interested in making one of those? And I said, I'd love to do that. I think that'd be kind of fun, and it'd be something different for us to do. And then obviously this would tie into the lore. And the one advantage too is that because both of them would sit in my pocket, you wouldn't have to worry about, well, the lore doesn't have anything to do with the book, and the book doesn't have anything to do with the lore. Whatever changes got made to either would go into both. And also too, I think it was a little bit of a payback because originally, whenever there had been talk about a Dungeon Siege movie, he'd actually said, I'm going to give you the first shot at writing the script. But obviously that wasn't entirely in his hands. Microsoft was the publisher, and so they got to make all the decisions. And then it got sold to UA Bolt. And if you've seen In the Name of the King, you know the wonderful, magnificent epic that was. But my name was in the movie. After the entire population of Germany. If you look for special thanks to, I'm the first name at the top of the special thanks to list. That was a classic example of having nothing to do with whatever I wrote. It has some names of some characters. Other than that, nothing to do with whatever. But one of these days, I actually have kind of threatened you. Have you ever heard of Riff Tracks?
Yes.
Or whatever. I've threatened to do my own Riff Tracks track of Dungeon Siege in the Name of the King for people and let them download, because my own commentary about that movie. And so some friends and I actually went to the movie and we did exactly that. It was totally, well, here we were, all the bots sitting around doing our own own track to that. So one of these days I might actually record that and release that for people so they can play along and get Neal's commentary about what they did to my horrible story. Wild Man. Again, I really want them to be able to make this story. And I cannot emphasize, well, Chris, of course, is, doesn't want people to talk too much about, I don't want people to give us money because they feel sorry for us and whatever. And of course, we had that day that right after Chris had announced they had to have the layoffs and everything in order to basically keep the company afloat. And of course they had this enormous spike in giving. It was immediately afterwards. And I said, man, I think you're looking at it the wrong way. As I said, this is not a matter of feeling sorry for you. I think you say that at Gas Power Games, you have an incredibly talented group of people making great games. You have a resume of stuff that you have on your resume. Most people would kill to have a resume like that. That I made all of this awesome, incredible stuff. And it's people are handing you money because we don't want you to go away. You're a fantastic studio, whether it's belief in this particular product or you're saying, I just want you to stay open so you can make Kings and Castles. I want you to go on and, get the money back and rebuy Dungeon Siege's license and get the license back and do that. People are saying, we love gas powered games. We love you, Chris, because you've done fantastic, magnificent things for us. And I think that it just makes me sad to see the things happening that's kind of happened to Chris, kind of being shoved in this corner, because he's one of the last people in the world that deserve this. You know, I've been doing this for 23 years now. I've worked for all kinds of different companies and different bosses. And something I'll reiterate that I've said in other places, and I am going to post my own little video on YouTube, just basically this fact so people understand, is that there's obviously this wild man in the game itself, and it's fantastic. I think some cool ideas are coming up with it. I hope that people, everybody else will rally together and help kind of pull us over the line. But I also want to say something about Chris himself. I got to know Chris, again, as I said before, is that we were both working for Cave Dog, and he was working on Total Annihilation, and I was working on Elysium, but his office was right next door to John Cutter's office, and so whenever I was going up and we were visiting and doing stuff, I saw Chris Taylor all the time. Then later on, when he moved over to Gas Powered Games and he got his gig going, I was one of the first people that he contacted to kind of let me know, say, hey, man, I got a new studio. I got some cool stuff. And then obviously that relationship is what eventually laid the groundwork for Dungeon Siege. It's 2004. We were starting to work on Supreme Commander. You know, we were starting to do the backstory for Supreme Commander and start to flesh out what the world was going to be, working with a great guy at the time, Evan Pongress, who was working on it. And we did a lot of interaction together on stuff. So I'm working on the Bible for the world. And about this time, my wife, Jaina, was diagnosed with an extremely rare, dangerous form of breast cancer, which 50% of the people were alive after 2 years. 30% of the people were alive after 5. It was just, I was completely destroyed. We'd already gone through a round. Jane had breast cancer before. The thing about it is, most people don't understand is there are different varieties of breast cancer. It's not a monolithic disease. There are all kinds of sub-varieties. So anyway, we're working on the Bible for Supreme Commander. And I was having a very hard time getting through everything else because all I'm thinking about is my future. Is she going to be live? Blah, blah, blah. And so Chris could see that I was having a real hard time with things. And at one point, he basically pulled me aside. He said, you know, I don't want you to worry about all this other stuff with Supreme Commander. I want you to go home. Take care of your wife. She's the only important thing right now. And he cut me a check. He says, go home, take care of your wife. And that's, you know, I want you to, that's the only important thing in the world. That's who Chris Taylor is. And that's why that man needs to stay in business. Because he cares about his employees. He will fight for you. He will do anything he can for you. There are so many people, I've worked for all kinds of different people in the world, but he's one of those people that he crusaded for 40-hour work weeks. That doesn't exist in the game industry anywhere else. They expect you're going to work a 70-hour work week. You know, most game companies look for people who are single. You know, they don't have a wife, they don't have a kid. I don't have to pay insurance on them. I can work them 80 hours a week. And they don't care. They're just going to be glad to be there. And that's not Chris at all. You know, he cares that you have a personal life. He wants you to have a great life that's going on. And by God, you know, that there's just no reason that man should be put out of business. And so, sorry, I'm just getting a little misty eyes and a little kind of emotional list here or whatever. But I will fight to the death for that man. Back Wildman, please. It's a great game. Grass Powered Games make fantastic stuff, and make sure this guy stays in business. So.
Yeah, I feel myself getting a little misty-eyed. When I was interviewing him earlier about the game, he was so upset because of the idea that people would care so much that they would pledge more than they were comfortable with financially. And this, I could tell this was really bothering him. And I just thought, I mean, you're one of a kind, Chris. I mean, how many people would actually be telling people to pledge to give back, or lower their pledges?
You say that, okay, well, I'm not bidding on an individual. I'm not bidding on whatever, and say, then, say, yeah, okay, you're bidding on a particular project or what have you. And sure, he said, if that's a particular case, there are hundreds of thousands of other games on you can back on Kickstarter. If that's all you care about, that's fine, or whatever. But honestly, say, there has to be at some point some reward in this universe for being a decent human being. You talk about paying it forward. Chris has paid it forward to every single member of the team, people who have worked for him over the years. That man has, I'm a good friend of Chris's. I've talked to him over the years about stuff that's happened. I've heard a lot of the stuff that happened inside the company. And honest to God, that man has opened to basically keep the company open and to help his employees out. And so, there's a time whenever you say, what, commander's been injured, we got to rally around the flag, we save the commander, and this is one of those times. And you can make an argument, oh well, how did you get in this situation, you must not be very good at whatever and blah blah blah. And I said, yeah, that's a really brilliant, completely short-sighted way of looking at things. I have been on projects that did really, really well that, I don't know, they weren't really that great. They're the right place at the right time. And I've been worked on really fabulous projects that got canceled or that didn't do well because they had bad marketing or it was just not the right time for that right game. And so I think that's where Chris is right now. And I think that's where Gas Powered is they went through a rough time. They had Age of Empires basically canceled out underneath them. That wasn't their decision. It wasn't their fault. And so sometimes you just got to basically reach out and do the George Bailey, pass the hat around. You got to save this, the best guy in town, and you got to take care of George Bailey. And so I say, just go watch it. It's a Wonderful Life and regrow your heart, man. You got to
And
help.
there's plenty of jerks out there, but even in our interview, we talked about Elysium and Thief of Dreams, and I keep thinking, man, I wish there would have been something like Kickstarter at the time, just some way for the fans to rush in and say, no, we're going to make this thing.
Well, I mean, it's the thing about it is, if you work in the industry long enough, you're going to have more than your share of canceled titles, things that got bad reviews. It's just part of being a developer is you have to be a risk taker, and occasionally you're going to do something that people don't like. Occasionally you're going to do stuff that the company, Cave Dog was kind of an example. Is it wasn't even a judgment call on us. The company was in financial trouble. They've overextended themselves, and so we got axed because we were the most risky title that they had. And in retrospect, I don't want, if I'd been Ron Gilbert, I'd been sitting in the same circumstance, yeah, I would axe us too, because this is not a surefire hit. It might do really, really well, and it might crash and burn. Who knows? And that's the hard part, the hard decision you have to make whenever you're sitting at the top of that company. And people have kind of judged Chris about the whole, really laid off his whole team and say, if you're really oversimplifying the situation by orders of magnitude, he's not doing it. He wants to buy another island in the Virgin Islands. Is he made that choice so that if he had the choice of, if I let them go, if I wait until the end of the Kickstarter campaign, I won't have any money for severance. These guys have nothing. So bang, you're out of work. You don't have any money. I can't give you your paid time off money. You're just done. Well, he's the option is I can let you go and you have severance, and so you can start looking for work tomorrow. And so he's doing this out of the goodness of his heart. I've worked for companies that literally told you, oh, and by the way, we're laying everybody off today. Sorry. You know, they didn't even know it was coming. You know, and no severance. And I've been in that circumstance, and it just sucks. It's horrible. And so Chris has at least basically bought these guys time to say, okay, I'm going to have a little bit of money in the bank, and I can make my own decision as I'm a grown up, as I can make it my decision about, am I going to look for another job? What am I going to do with my time? And I mean, it's a terrible, it's right now it's a terrible economy. And also added the fact that, my God, there's so many incredible, amazing people that are out there in the job market right now. And I'm fully, you know, I'm in that same pool, right? I've been out of a full-time gig for over a year. The company I was working for, last company I worked for was Hands On Entertainment. They went, you know, toes up February of last year. And so it's rough out there. And the thing about it is it's getting rougher and rougher because all these studios are popping, which means the competition is harder and harder and harder, you know, and, it would be fantastic if there were tons of companies waiting to gobble you up, you know, all these brand new companies that have these fantastic new jobs, but it's just like handfuls of companies that have just a few positions that are open, and who knows whether those companies are going to be there in another 5 or 6 months. Do you want to relocate halfway across the country and the odds that that the company you just bought into will still be there? So it's scary. It's very, very scary stuff. So just hope that things improve for everybody. Sometime soon.
Do you think that we're at the worst point of this crisis as far as the games economy is concerned, or do you think we're at a cliff?
It's really hard to say. I mean, to be honest, it's like what's going to be interesting to see what happens is see if Kickstarter really turns into, because the chatter is now is this is the new model. You know, the publisher model is dying, and you know, it's that. That idea is going to go away, and it's going to be, we go to a model where we have a Kickstarter, and we basically see, it's basically a gauge to see, is there really enough money or is enough interest? It's a marketing thing almost. Is there enough interest to bother making this game? You know, let the gamers vote with their bucks about whether they want to see this game made. And if they don't, we don't even have to worry about doing, you know, which games to fund, to fully fund, and which ones not. Is it's easy for us. This was a successful Kickstarter. They failed, so they don't deserve to go on. You know, I see that because, you know, can you make a game for $1.1 million? Can you make it for $3 million? Can you make it for $10? They say, what does this mean? Does it mean that the games, I need to make my games small enough that I could make them for $1.1 million. Do I need to make them smaller? They're half the size. Do we see epic games that you know, you play for 20 or 30 or 50 or 100 hours? Do those go away because we can't afford those anymore? Unfortunately, I do not have a crystal ball. That's when we start getting outside of, because we start going into economic, financial, you know, how the vast economic market forces work, and that unfortunately gets outside of my. So we talk about trends. I'm same agreement with Chris, just in terms of I think we're going increasingly mobile. I think we are going to see more and more browser-based games. I think that the costs of licensing an engine are becoming more and more reasonable. And I think so as a result, you're going to see more browser kind of based stuff, that doesn't necessarily mean Facebook games. It just means that, you know, something that I don't necessarily have I buy this game, I download it on my computer and everything else. I have something that can update itself all the time. We still have to get connection speeds high enough and those engines meaty enough that they can handle it, but I think they'll get there. I think we're making the first steps. I have it in mind that I'm going to do a few tablet-based titles if and when I can get around to doing it. And so those are going to be small. They're not going to be some big, huge monster kind of things. The whole larger economic thing, I'm not nearly smart enough to crack that particular nut. If I were, I wouldn't be making games for a living.
So you might expect to see a tablet PC game from you in the near future, perhaps a Betrayal at Sierra.
um, um, there will be a tablet game. I have something I'm kind of doodling with right now. Surprise, surprise. You know, it is kind of Lovecraftian kind of inspired stuff. It's called Tablonomicon. And
Tablonomicon.
But anyway, I just have some very, very early kind of stuff with it right now. And no huge rush on it because I'm doing all the coding for it myself. So I have not really pulled out my coding skills in quite a long time. I do scripting kinds of stuff, but this is much, much heavier lifting than I've had to do in quite a while. So don't expect it anytime soon. It'll happen when it happens. I'd hope to have it done a little bit faster, but it's been slower going than I hoped. And also, because I have my fingers in numerous pies, as you said before, because I have this, you know, the Wild Man thing that, again, I hope that flies. We get a novel. There's my buddy's web series that's hoping going to be kickstarting sometime soon, called Crypto Historians. I'm the director of photography on that one, you know, so I have a lot of film stuff that I'm doing these days as well. So it's just kind of like whatever gets done first.
And that's all for this week's episode. Hope you guys enjoyed that. I should be back next week with a brand new retrospective. And I'm not going to tell you guys which game I'm choosing. You'll just have to wait and see. But I think you're really going to enjoy that. As always, I want to thank you very, very much, guys. If you have donated and supported this show, it means a great deal to me. It's the only thing that keeps these episodes coming to you every week. So if you like Matt Chat, please consider taking a few minutes to visit armchairarcade.com. Go to the Matt Chat link in the top right corner. You can set up a weekly subscription, monthly subscription, or a one-time donation. A dollar a month, a dollar a week. It might not sound like anything to you, but it actually does make a difference. So please take a few minutes to do that if you haven't already. If you have, thank you very much. Also, if you'd like to get a signed copy of Honoring the Code, Conversations with Great Game Designers, remember these are based on interviews I've done here on the show. I think every Matt Chat fan should have one. If you would like a signed copy, I'll give it to you for $40 plus the cost of shipping. And it looks like the ones that I've sent so far to European countries, there's one to Russia, that's been about $24, $24, $25 for that. Within the US, it should be more like $12. So if you like a copy of that, just let me know. Send me an email, use YouTube, or post something at Armchair Arcade and I'll see that. Facebook, you know, there's so many ways to contact me, but just let me know. I'd like for you to have a copy of that if you want one. Okay, so what about that ale of the week? Now this week I've got a little number here called the Fatty Boom Baladdy. This is brewed in Black River Falls, Wisconsin, so not far away. It's quote, unrepentant, unpretentious, and unfiltered. Our Belgian-style ale features a touch of wheat and plenty of hops, dangerously drinkable. This is from the Furthermore Brewing Company at furthermorebeer.com. Kind of a cool link. I've been looking here on the bottle. I do not see anything else about it. So let's just get it open and see what it's all about. All right, so I got some of this Fatty Boom Baladdy here in this rather excellent drinking horn. I've been smelling this. Just smells really, really nice, very fragrant and fresh. You can smell the sort of wheat in there. You can smell the sort of peachy aroma. It definitely smells like what you would expect a wheat ale to smell like, a good one. Now, taste-wise, this is very thick and creamy. You can taste a lot of hops in this. It's a lot of hoppier than I would expect. Definitely a lot hoppier than, say, a Blue Moon. Quite nice. It's got a vaguely sort of a metallic taste to it. It's not quite up to five horns, but it's really, really good. I've had a lot of wheat ales. It's one of my favorite styles, I guess. So this one, I'm going to go 4 out of 5 drinking horns on this. Really smooth. It's got a nice creamy texture to it. Smells wonderful. the only thing I don't like about it is that sort of slightly metallic taste. It's just barely there, but it's there enough to notice. So if we're going to go 4 out of 5 on this, then get rid of that, I'll go 5 out of 5. Anyway, let's wrap this up with a quotation. And the quotation for this week comes from Andrew Carnegie, looking for somebody that knew a little something about business. And the quotation goes something like this. No man will make a great business who wants to do it all himself or to get all the credit. See you guys next week.
What is that?
His name's Bodai.
I think he heard you.
Of course he heard me. He hears everything. Even when I'm not talking, he hears me. Here. He likes to be held.
It does. I can feel it likes to be held. Hey, Bodhi.
His name is Bodai. Jason, can we keep him?